Sorry. In the process, we also help governments opening up data. So currently, we're working with the government of Telangana. So I thought I'll talk about, in general, the challenges in opening up data and our experience with, you know, the government of Telangana. So this is from the preamble of the Right to Information Act. So I'm sure most of you know Right to Information Act that was passed in the year 2005, hailed as one of the best legislation this country has ever seen. This is from the preamble. So most of what we are talking about in open data or information from the government actually flows from this preamble. So it talks about, you know, we need to have an informed citizenry, and informed citizenry is not possible without government supplying information. And informed citizenry in the process will help in, you know, controlling corruption and ensuring that all the government, you know, instrumentalities in terms of bureaucracy, the political system is accountable. Now, so there is a specific provision in the Right to Information Act, which is called Section 4, which actually talks about proactive disclosure from the government. So right now, if you, you know, people with experience in dealing right to information applications would know that it is mostly demand-based. So you make an application, government will supply whatever information. But there is also a supply-based provision in the Act, which a lot of people do not know, which is Section 4. Section 4 actually talks about proactive disclosure from the government of about 17 items, which actually covers budgets as well. So when we talk about open data actually flows from Section 4, where governments, without people asking for it, should actually disclose. Now, we say it shouldn't be that data is available, but people cannot access it. So after the advent of Right to Information, it's close to 12 years now. So I can show you the transformation. So this is pre-2005, municipal medical records in a government hospital to collect rate in Nalgonda. Now, this took a long time, of course, 12 years, and I'm not trying to say that this is the situation in every office. It has changed. But unfortunately, this hasn't helped us go here. So we still deal with, like Gaurav was saying, PDFs, unstructured data. You know, even when you use RTI, people give you physical formats. So while information is now open, people are able to access information, it's still, quote-unquote, not machine readable and in the form that we want. So ideally, we want governments to open up data. In the sense, every government, like, you know, one of them was saying that they publish in a structured format that people can readily use. So briefly, let's talk about the government structure. I think that will clarify a lot of things, that questions people have. So, you know, let us not be under the assumption that the government is a monolith. Government is not a monolith. So each government department is their own boss. So at the central government level, there is this ministry called the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation, which usually generates a lot of data, especially for policy framing. So they have three different wings. One is the National Sample Survey Office. You might have heard about national sample surveys. So these are surveys done on a certain sample size covering all the states. So every once in a while. So they don't take 10 years like the census. They're done, so some of them done twice every 5 years, some of them once every 10 years, and so on and so forth. Then there is the Central Statistical Office, which calculates our GDP. So you must have heard about this office recently because of the whole, you know, that fiasco about is the government fudging GDP data, etc. So this, the chief statistician comes from here. So they publish GDP data, they publish inflation data, and all that. The third one is a program implementation wing within the MOSPI. So this actually monitors a lot of big infrastructure projects. It's called IFMD. They also have something called as IFMD, Infrastructure Management Division. So they regularly monitor all the big infra projects. Now within this, they also have, you know, MOSPI has, Government of India has come up with a guideline some time ago where they said any big project of Government of India or any scheme for that matter, which has an outlay of more than 150 crores, will have to be monitored and will have to have an online system that people can, government can track it. So which is why you see a lot of schemes with a huge outlay of hundreds of crores usually have a working MIS. Yeah. So this is at the central government level. Now while, is this the only department that generates data? No. This is one of the departments, but their only job is generation of data. But on the other side, you have every department, every ministry at the Government of India level generating data, like, for example, the Ministry of Finance generating budget data year after year, the Ministry of Health generating some other health survey data. So it is not as if there is a unified vision of data generation where we say, you know, every government entity will generate data in a specified format. So that's one issue. At the state government level, we have Department of Planning. At the state level, each state has a Department of Planning. So this acts like MOSPI at the state level. So we have state level data of economic surveys that are released during budget time. So within the Department of Planning, we have the Directorate of Economics and Statistics. So they release annual reports of states every year if you follow annual reports. So this is more like a statistical snapshot of the state. So every year they release this report. Now, most NSS surveys also have state component in it, in the sense they also release data of the state level, what is happening at the state level. Like I said, all other line departments also generate a lot of data for their own need and purpose. And there are independent agencies which, quote unquote, are within the control of the government, they also generate data based on the need. So I'm sure the problem is pretty clear now. So it's not as if there is one standard, one agency mandating the data should be generated in a certain way. So part of the problem is this. So even, for example, even a village panchayat, the lowest tier of governance, also generates data for their own need. Now, briefly about the National Sample Survey. So the NSS does surveys on varied subjects, broadly four subjects. The first one is socioeconomic. So this includes savings survey and spending survey, and travel pattern survey, and various other things. So if you go to the MOSPI website, you'll find all these interesting surveys. They also do a five-year survey on, every 5 years they do this survey on landholding, livestock, and agriculture. So, you know, you'll find what is the average landholding in India, how many are small farmers, how many are marginal farmers, how many are, you know, large farmers. Same with livestock. They also have a livestock census that goes with normal census of human beings, and the agricultural census. They also do surveys on establishment and enterprise. So number of establishments, you know, in each sector, number of employees, number of labor. Then village surveys. They also do a lot of village level surveys to understand village issues. So broadly, these are the subjects under which MOSPI, the National Sample Survey Office, works. So like I said, how is data generated in the first place? So firstly, a lot of data even today, especially in the large schemes, is still manually entered. Now there are multiple issues here. Well, I'll tell you a case study of the NREGS. So we have, for example, for most government schemes which, for example, the NREGS, the key is the muster roll. So muster roll is more like a sheet in which the names of people who attended that day's work is written and with their signature. So muster roll is proof that you attended that day's work and you are entitled to a certain amount of you know, that day's labor. So we still, a lot of data at the grassroots level is still generated in physical forms and then manually entered. So you can see there is scope for error there. Then we have some automated applications where, especially with respect to wherever we do GIS tagging, so they do use automated applications. And there are various registers which are later converted into, you know, the physical data is converted into machine readable form. So these days, for example, you know, at least in Telangana, one of the departments has been using WhatsApp extensively to collect data. So from schools, so all the school headmasters would WhatsApp data in a specified format for 5-6 parameters, and then this goes to the central office where it is converted into an Excel. Then finally, this Excel is so there are varied formats in which data is collated and generated. And like I said, automated, so especially with transaction data, so wherever government is involved in transactions, so that data is automated. I'll briefly explain about the flow of the NREGS. I'm sure all of you know the National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme, which was introduced in the year 2005 after the UPA came to power. So this was their flagship project. So it talks about providing wage employment to all the rural people. So it doesn't differentiate between a rich man and a poor man. So any individual living in a rural area is entitled to get work. Now, though this is probably one scheme with the largest outlay in this country. So in the last 10 years, the outlay has been more than 3 lakh crores across the country. So if you look at this, the first one is registration of the worker. This happens physically. So at the Gram Panchayat office, there is a form that one needs to fill saying I want to get enrolled as a worker. So you'll have to submit a few proofs. That is the first step. And after this is done, this is actually entered into the system. So PE talks about post-event. So it's not real-time entry into the system. But once those physical forms are filled, bunch of them go to, usually what happens is, again, I'm speaking from a Telangana experience, it could be different in different states. Usually the block office has a dedicated place where about 5 to 10 systems would be there with internet connection. And all people from the village collect these physical forms, go to the block office, they reserve some time and then do this entry. So most offices at the block level use that dedicated space for online entry. So then you have issuance of the job card. So once you apply for work, so if the form is proper, then you're issued a job card. Again, this is physical. Then demand for work. So the scheme is a demand-based scheme. It's not supply-based scheme. So in other words, I as a worker can go and demand for work, saying, you know, I don't have any other work elsewhere, so I want to work. So that demand is captured. This also, in some states, it's happening real time, not in all states. Then work allocation. So how it works is there is a shelf of works decided by the Gram Panchayat. So there is a list of works. And ideally, the Gram Panchayat should decide that work should be taken up as priority. So there are a lot of criteria involved. So then work allocation happens. Then e-muster, of course, like I said, e-muster is not there in all states. Some states are doing it. E-muster is like the electronic muster. So once work happens, you capture the attendance, then the muster is generated where it talks, where it has names of workers along with the amount that they should be paid. And then if you see the entire flow, so the daily attendance, preparation of MBA is measurement book. So once the work is done, there is a technical engineer who comes in, measures the work done. And based on the measurement, there's something known as schedule of rate, SOR. So based on the schedule of rate, based on the amount of work done, a particular wage rate is decided. So it is, could be 100, 150, 170, and that is transferred to the wage seeker's bank account. Then the preparation of wage list, wage slip, FTO is nothing but a financial transfer order, which talks about money actually going to the wage seeker's account. So this is the entire flow. Now, as you know, it is actually very, very complex. And we are only talking about one scheme of the Government of India, which, you know, in terms of budgetary figures, it's less than 5% of government's budget at an overall level. So you can imagine the complexity we are dealing with. So to tell you the format, so these are the physical formats. So job card, application for job card. So somebody has to apply in this format, an application for work. Of course, these are translated into local languages. They're not available in English. Then this is how the muster roll looks like, the physical muster roll, then transformed into the electronic muster roll. And this is how it happens on the ground. So this is the work site, this is the engineer measuring, and again the engineer measuring. So this is a work, road laying work. This is, for example, building a tank, water tank. So you can imagine the complexity. So this is a snapshot from the NRG MI. So this is one scheme, like I said, with schemes with a huge outlay, we have a working MIS. So if you go to nrga.nic.in, so all this data that I explained to you before is available on that MIS, the snapshot from that MIS. So you can actually go up to the worker level, wage seeker level, to understand what kind of works did he do in the last so many years, what was the amount of money that was given to him in the last so many years, the kind of works done at a block level, at a village level. So what is the ratio between material and men? So all that. Now, just to understand the complexity of this data, like I told you, the expenditure in the last 10 years has been close to more than 3 lakh crore. How many percentages of work was generated? 1980 crore percentage, which is 18 times of population. Then there are 25 crore wage seekers, not active, but people who are enrolled into this scheme till date. Then there are about more than 12 crore works that were done on the ground. And on an average, every day, about 50 lakh percentages of work is generated. So in other words, ballpark average, about 50 lakh people get work from government. So this is the complexity we're dealing with. Now, what is the status of data generation, data disclosure in the government? Like I said, for major schemes, we do have MIS at various levels. there's a central government MIS, there'll be a state government MIS. So the data will be available in some structured format. So pensions, PDS, so all the schemes with huge outlay, you have this. Then for smaller schemes, we have data that is maintained at local systems. So we don't have it on the internet, so it should be on the computer of, you know, some clerk or some officer. So it will be in his system. So there could be schemes with an outlay of 5 crore, 6 crore. They don't have an MIS, but still 5 crore, 6 crore is not a small amount. So they are maintained at a local level. And then still, for example, village budgets. So though we have Panchayat Raj Ministry software to capture village budget, it's still not. So a lot of villages still follow the manual paper budgeting procedure. Let me spend some time in talking about this. Now, a lot of people think technology is the issue, in the sense, you know, the issue in opening up government data is technology. No, that's not the case. The bigger issue in opening up government data is trying to change their culture. So they have a culture of secrecy. It's gone on for close to 60 years now. And the same kind of resistance we see even in right information. So when somebody applies under RTI, getting information, I know if somebody has applied, you will know the pain. So the first thing that anybody has to deal with is the culture. How do we make them understand that you are part of the changing culture? It's no more secret. A lot of government officials derive their power from holding this information. So it is very, very difficult to part with this information. So they feel that everybody then will become powerful. Their power is taken away. So culture is a huge issue. So while we might discount saying, you know, why can't the government just mandate everybody to do, it's not as easy. The second one is fear. There's a lot of fear within the government government bureaucracy about misuse of data. So for example, this also partly comes from their own understanding of technology. Because, you know, there was an official who was telling me, if I put an Excel on the internet, can somebody not download the Excel, change it, and upload it back? So this was his fear, that somebody would actually change the data. So this partly came from his own lack of understanding of technology, and partly from, you know, because at the end of the day, they have rules that are very strict, and anything that happens with data, they are liable. So these are two big challenges. You know, wherever you go, if you talk to government officials at various levels, these are two big fears. The third one is lack of capacity. Frankly speaking, does our government have the capacity to handle data at this scale? Frankly, no. So how are they able to manage today? So each department has their own vendor. So yes, government has a technology wing called the National Informatics Center, but not every state government or every scheme is handled by them. So I'll tell you an example. You know, health department, for example, in Telangana has 8 different modules, 8 different modules, and each one is developed by a different vendor. So partly one reason, because they don't have that big picture understanding, they tend to do temporary work. So I have a need today, I need a solution today, let me develop something. But how does it actually connect to what is already there? How does it connect in the long term? People don't understand. So these are, I think, 4 big reasons, challenges in opening up data. So while there is a lot of work on the technology front, I believe in India especially, we are not working enough on the first two. On changing the culture, trying to tell them that it's a changed world, it's no more 1950s, 60s. So we are facing the same issues with right information as well. So when people ask that culture of sharing information. Then, I'll briefly tell you about the Telangana Open Data Initiative, what we're trying to do. Small video. Yeah, I hope you all understand. I'll move to the next slide. So what we're trying to do with the Telangana Open Data Policy is actually addressing the first two. You know, while we're also addressing technology, not that we are discounting technology. So the government does not believe in going belligerent and opening up, you know, all data sets, but wants to take it in a phase-wise manner where we talk to officials, explain it to them that, you know, why sharing is important. How can we change their own internal culture of data sharing? Then we're also focusing on, like I said, the challenges. So we intend to hold regular community events. I'll also tell you an example. So I'm not sure how many of you know, Telangana government has reorganized its districts. So the earlier 10 districts are now 31. So even, for example, Google does not have maps today of those 31. So the government will soon release. They're finalizing boundaries. So we already have a dedicated data portal. It's called data.telangana.gov.in. There are very few data sets, but the intention is to make this more active. So these are the new districts. The shape files are getting ready, as in the boundaries are getting finalized. So very soon the government will release them. So I'll one more case study and we'll probably end it. So Ma Bhumi is the comprehensive land records portal of the government of Telangana. So it has land records up to a village level, so up to the individual beneficiary level. So it's in each state it's called by a different name. In Telangana it's called Pahani, village Pahani. Pahani is nothing but a register that contains the land records. Now for each land ownership record, there are more than 10 parameters that are there in this MIS. For example, if this is a screenshot, it's in Telugu, so it talks about the total extent, how much is cultivable, how much is not cultivable, what is the source of water for that particular land ownership, who is the owner, then various other things like that. So what kind of land is it? Is it dry land, wet land, various other stuff. So you know, what can be done with this? So we had a community event where a few students developed this. So we wanted to develop a village dashboard. So at a village level, can we, this is one data set, the agriculture data set. So can we, in the same way, can we source more data sets and then prepare a village level dashboard for planning? So for example, this comes from the Ma Bhumi website as an example. What we had done was to understand the land ownership in that village. So what is the total ownership, average ownership, how many small farmers, big farmers. So how much of the land is actually cultivable? So what kind of sources does that village have, etc. So going forward, the idea is, you know, take such case studies, take such data sets and involve community in developing various solutions. So probably I'll discuss this in the OTR session. We don't have enough time. So what do we expect from the community? Like I said, the government intends to hold regular events. We'll keep informing you. So please participate in them. Then please provide suggestions or requests for data sets. Like I said, the data that you want may not be available, but if it's available, we'll try and push departments. Please come up with solutions. So a lot of problems to be solved. So government is open. If you have an idea that can actually solve a real problem, please come forward. And if you have any ideas, please write to that email ID, opendata@telangana.gov. Thank you.
We can have a few questions. Question this side?
So there is a already existing portal of open data.gov.in. So how different is your approach towards that from the data set?
Yeah.
I see a lot of data set being uploaded there and that's still available public.
Yeah. Data.gov.in, like you know, is the Government of India portal. And Government of India usually has aggregated data of states. So the data comes from central government departments. As you know, the real, if you want to call the useful data, would be hyperlocal data, not the aggregated data. So usually the central government does not hold hyperlocal data, it is with the state governments. So what the data portal of Telangana intends to do is provide that hyperlocal data. So aggregated data, we are not trying to reinvent the wheel, so which is already available in data.gov.in. It will probably, the data set will also be available here, but the idea is not that. So true.
Hi, first of all, this is regarding the rural employment scheme. This is regarding the rural employment scheme. So, is there an insurance for these people? Say, who
is
work?
That?
Is there an insurance for these people who are working?
No, there is no insurance.
There's no insurance because
there is an accident claim, accident compensation, but there is no insurance. The compensation given if something happens to you while you are on work.
But that is only for the BPL, right?
That's
only for the BPL, right? Below poverty line.
The rural employment guarantee scheme does not differentiate BPL, APL. So it's anybody living in a rural area, if you want work, you can demand work from government.
So work is different from insurance.
Yeah.
So work is different from insurance, right? So because APL and BPL both work, but what I read recent times is like it's only the insurance is only covered or accidental insurance is only covered for the BPL and not for APL.
No, no, there's, see, like I said, as far as I know, I could be wrong, but there is compensation for accidents on site. There's no insurance as such.
More questions?
So you've developed this whole model for Telangana, which we know is like a new state, so you can have all the latest technologies and the latest trends implemented in it. Now, once you've developed this model, how modular is it that other states can adapt it? Like, how have you taken that thought into consideration?
Yeah, though Telangana is a new state, it has a legacy of the last 60 years. So the new state is only in the name. So the state still has all the ills that you see in a typical bureaucracy. So in that way, the state is not different, but the leadership is very open in terms of changing. Now, when we say modules, see, I'm actually not talking more about technology. So for example, the data portal of the state is actually developed in an open source platform called DCAN, so which is another version of CCAN. What we are intending to do is build a model by which where we force changes in the culture and not just, you know, give them a technology, mandate something, and then make them give data sets today and tomorrow when you and I are not there, data set doesn't come. So that is precisely what is happening with data.gov today at the government level. So it is not a legislation, so we have to understand. So this is still a policy where we say, where we ask government departments, request them to open up data. So in terms of our priorities, so once the state is successful in opening up a lot of data and actually solving problems, it being useful to various stakeholders, the idea is to document all this and share it with whoever wants to. It will be available on the website as well.
One last question.
I want to ask, like you talked about different kind of data you collect, that is socio-economic landholding. I'm curious to know, like, is there any geospatial kind of data like which you collect and like addresses or bus stops?
See, again, it varies from department to department. So for example, if bus stops have to be captured, it is a municipal corporation that has to do it. So there is no agency. Yes, there is a an agency that deals with geospatial in every government. So we have something known as TS track, but their mandate is not to geotag everything. So their mandate is to prepare maps and boundaries. So it is a department's priority. So if bus stops have to be mapped, the local municipal corporation has to do it. So there is no, I wouldn't say the geospatial data is being generated at a large scale today, but there is an effort in certain departments to do it. So most of the, for example, the NRGA works are now geotagged. Most NRGA works are now geotagged. In terms of, you know, where was the work done, what kind of work. And in large schemes, it is happening definitely. But in smaller schemes and smaller departments, it's not yet done. Which data? Which is what I'm telling you. So right now, the data portal of Telangana is very, very nascent. So you won't have a lot of data sets, very, very basic data sets, the baseline data sets. So in the days to come, we intend to do that. Not right now, but yeah, in future. Probably in six to 12 months.
Thanks, Rakesh. That was a great talk. And people who have more questions can catch Rakesh and Gaurav at the OTR session, which starts at 2:05 p.m. in room.